Contour Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Under the Hammer, Edward I and Scotland, by Fiona Watson, narrated by Mhairi Morrison. Publisher's note: the print and ebook versions of this book include visual elements. You will hear the visuals discussed and referenced in this audiobook. Dramatis Personae. Abernethy, Sir Alexander. Scott, Warden from 4th to Grampians, 1303-5. Abingdon, Richard. Royal Officer, Receiver of Cumberland, 1297-1300. Made Baron of Exchequer, 1299. Allard, Sir Gervais of Winchelsea, Sussex, Captain of the Cinque Ports, Admiral of English Fleet, 1300-1. Alexander II, King of Scots, 1214-49. Alexander III, King of Scots, 1249-86. Amersham, Walter, Edward I's Chancellor of Scotland, 1296-1304, also Receiver of Northumberland, died 1304. Angus, Gilbert de Umfraville, Earl of, Lord of Reedsdale and Coquetdale in Northumberland, died 1307. Athol, John de Strathbogey, Earl of, Scottish Sheriff of Aberdeen, circa 1300, brother-in-law of Robert Bruce, the future king, lieutenant and justiciar of Scotland beyond Forth, 1304-5, died 1306. Audley, Sir Hugh, Gloucestershire Knight, keeper of Selkirk Forest, 1301 to circa 1303, died 1325. Balliol, Sir Alexander, Lord of Cavers, Sheriff of Selkirk, 1301 to circa 1303. Balliol, John, Lord of Barnard Castle, County Durham, and Galloway, claimant to Scottish throne, King of Scots, 1292-1296, 1304, died 1313. Balmoral, Nicholas, of St. Andrews, Scottish Chancellor, circa 1301. Bartholomew, Roger, Burgess of Berwick, first to appeal from Scottish courts to Edward I, 1291-2. Barton Robert, Keeper of Abingdon's Counter Roll, 1297. Beecham, Sir Walter, Steward of Edward's Household. Beck, Anthony, Bishop of Durham, 1283-1311. Bensteed, John, Controller of the Wardrobe. Beavercoats, William, Royal Officer, Keeper of Edward's Seal in Scotland, 1296-7, Chancellor of Scotland, 1304-6. Bissett, William, Lord of Upsettlington, Berkshire, Sheriff of Clackmannan, 1303-4, and Stirling, 1304-5. Bissett, Sir Hugh, Lord of Antrim, captured Arran, 1298. Boniface the Eighth, Pope, died 1303. Botetourt, Sir John, Lord of Mendlesham, Suffolk, given Dalswinton Castle, 1301. Warden of Western March, 1302-4. Brabazon, Roger, English Royal Advisor, involved in great cause, later Chief Justice of the King's Bench. Brampton, Stephen, English Constable of Bothwell, 1298 to 1300, 1. Bremsgrave, Richard, Keeper of the Berwick Store, 1299 to circa 1303. Brittany, John of. Edward's nephew, Governor of Aquitaine, 1298 to 1305. Appointed Lieutenant of Scotland, 1305. Bruce, Robert of Annandale, the competitor, claimant to the Scottish throne, 5th Lord of Annandale, died 1295. Bruce, Robert, Earl of Carrick, 6th Lord of Annandale, became Earl through his wife, Marjorie, died 1304 in England. Bruce, Robert, Earl of Carrick, 7th Lord of Annandale, Guardian of Scotland, 1298 to 1300, King of Scots, 1306 to 29. Buncle, Thomas, Clerk of Dunkeld. Burden, Sir John, Nottingham and Derbyshire Knight, Sheriff of Berwick and Keeper of Castle, 1298 to circa 1303. Bergden, Sir Walter, Keeper of Carstairs Castle and Sheriff of Lanark, 1301 to 3. Justiciar of Galloway, 1305. Con, John of. Edward's notary public, responsible for drawing up Great Roll, circa 1296. Cantaloupe, Sir Robert, Essex Knight, Keeper of Lochmaben and Warden of Annandale, 1298-9. Carlisle, Bishop of. C. Halton. Cheney, Henry, Bishop of Aberdeen, 1282-1328. Brother of Sir Reginald. Cheney, Sir Reginald, Senior. Lord of Inverugie and Duffus, Sheriff of Inverness, 1296-7. Justiciar beyond the mountains, 1305. Brother of Henry, Bishop of Aberdeen. Clifford, Sir Robert, Lord of Appleby Castle, Westmoreland, given Carlaverloch Castle, Keeper of Carlisle Castle, 1297-9. Warden of Galloway, 1298-9. Keeper of the Bishopric of Durham, 1300-6. Cummin, Sir Alexander, brother of the Earl of Buchan, but on English side. Cummin, Sir Alexander, brother of Sir John Cummin of Badenoch, Senior. Cummin, Sir Edmund, of Kilbride, head of third branch of Cummin family, member of Sir John Cummin of Badenoch, Junior's council. Cummin, Sir John of Badenoch, Senior. Guardian, 1286-92. Brother-in-law of John Balliol, claimant to Scottish throne, died 1299. Cummin, Sir John of Badenoch, Jr., son of Sir John Cummin of Badenoch, Guardian, 1298-1303, 1303. Killed by Robert Bruce, 1306. Cummin, John, Earl of Buchan, cousin of Cummin of Badenoch, often leader of Scottish army, 1296-1303. Convers, Alexander, royal clerk responsible for provisioning English garrisons in southeast Scotland, 1298 to circa 1303. Crambeth, Matthew, Dean of Aberdeen, Bishop of Dunkeld, 1288 to 1309. Cressingham, Hugh, Treasurer of Scotland, 1296 7, killed at Battle of Stirling Bridge, 1297. Cunningham, Robert, nephew of James the Steward, Scottish Constable of Carlaverock, 1297-99. Delaleg, James, receiver in West, keeper of Carlisle Store, 1299-1303. Escheator south of Forth, 1303-5. Dolive, Sir John, keeper of Dumfries Castle, 1300. Douglas, Sir William, father of Sir James Douglas, the Good, died circa 1299. Droxford, John, keeper of the Wardrobe. Dunbar and March, Patrick, Earl of, claimant to throne, consistent English supporter, keeper of Berwick Town, 1298. Warden of Eastern March, 1298-9. Keeper of Ayr, circa 1301. Dunkeld, Bishop of, see Crambeth. Dunwich, Peter, royal officer, escheator south of Forth and keeper of Yester Castle, 1296-7. Durham, Sir William, knight of Essex and Hertfordshire, sheriff of Peebles, circa 1301, died 1304. Durham, Bishop of, see Beck. Edward I, King of England, 1272-1307. Edward of Carnarvon, Prince of Wales, future Edward II, died 1327. Alland, Sir Hugh, Yorkshire Knight, keeper of Jedburgh Castle and warden of Selkirk Forest, 1296-7. Felton, Sir Robert, Gloucestershire Knight, Constable of Lochmaben, 1299 to circa 1300. Felton, Sir William, Northamptonshire Knight with Northumbrian connections, keeper of Linlithgow Castle, 1301. Fitzalan, Sir Brian, Lord of Beedale in Yorkshire. Fitzmarmaduke, Sir John, custodian of Earl of Lincoln's lands of Strathgriff, forfeited from James the Steward. Fitzroger, Sir Robert, Lord of Clavering, Essex, keeper of Eastern Scottish March, 1299-1300. Fitzwarren, Sir William, Lord of Grimthorpe, Yorkshire, keeper of Uckert Castle, husband of Mary, Countess of Strathearn and Queen of Man, died 1317. Fitzwilliam, Sir Ralph, Northumberland Knight, Captain of Newcastle Garrison, 1297-9, Captain of Yorkshire Garrisons, 1298, Warden of Galloway, 1299. Fraser, Sir Simon, Lord of Oliver Castle, captured at Dunbar, made Edward's Warden of Selkirk Forest, 1297 to circa 1301, defected to Scots in 1301, died 1306. Fraser, William, Bishop of St. Andrews, 1279-97, Guardian of Scotland, 1286-92, great uncle of Sir Simon Fraser. Francis, Sir William, Constable of Kirkintilloch Castle, circa 1301. Furnival, Sir Thomas, Knight of Nottingham, Derby and Yorkshire, Captain of Nottingham and Derbyshire Garrisons, 1298. Galloway, Thomas of, illegitimate son of Alan, Lord of Galloway, prevented from succeeding his father by Alexander III. Gaveston, Piers, Gascon Knight, close friend of Edward II. Glasgow, Bishop of C. Wishart. Gloucester, Gilbert de Clare, Earl of. His great-aunt, Isabel, was wife of Robert Bruce the Competitor, died 1307. Gordon, Sir Adam, Scottish Warden of Western March, circa 1300, Justiciar of Lothian, 1305. Graham, Sir David, son of Sir Patrick Graham of Airth. Holton, John, Bishop of Carlisle, 1292 to 1324. Hastings, Sir Richard, Staffordshire Knight, Keeper of Jedburgh Castle, 1298 to 1305, brother of Sir Robert. Hastings, Sir Robert, Staffordshire Knight, Sheriff of Roxburgh and Keeper of Castle, 1296 to circa 1305, brother of Sir Richard. Hastings, Sir Edmund, Sheriff of Ayr, 1301, Warden of Berwick Town, 1302. Hastings, Sir John, claimant to Scottish throne. Henry I, King of England, 1100 to 35. Henry II, King of England, 1154 to 89. Henry III, King of England, 1216 to 72. Hereford, Humphrey de Bohun, Earl of. Constable of England, died 1298. Hereford, Humphrey de Bohun, Earl of, died 1322. Heron, Robert, Keeper of New Customs at Berwick, 1296 to circa 1304. Keeper of Counter Roll, 1297 to 1304. Controller of Chamberlain of Scotland, 1305 to 6. Heselrig, Sir William, Northumberland Knight, Sheriff of Lanark, killed by William Wallace in 1297. Hoddleston, Sir John, Knight of Cumberland, Yorkshire and Lancashire, Temporary Warden of Galloway, 1297, Captain of Cumberland and Westmoreland, 1303, died 1316. Holland, Florence, Count of, claimant to Scottish throne. Hunsengore, Master Thomas, King John's Chancellor. Huntercombe, Sir Walter, Oxfordshire Knight, Sheriff of Edinburgh, 1296 to 7, Keeper of Berwick Town, 1298, Captain of Northumberland Garrisons, 1298 to 1303, died 1313. Huntington, Earl David of, grandson of David I of Scotland, youngest son of Henry, Earl of Northumberland, brother of Malcolm IV and William I. Progenitor of Bruce, Balliol and Hastings, died 1219. Jarom, John, Royal Clerk, Keeper of Ayr Store, 1301. Joanby, Sir Robert, Cumberland Knight, Sheriff of Dumfries, 1296 to 7. Keith, Edward, brother of Sir Robert, claimed to be hereditary sheriff of Selkirk through his wife. Keith, Sir Robert, Scottish Warden of Selkirk Forest, 1299 to 1300. Justiciar, North of the Forth, 1306. Brother of Edward. Kingston, Sir John, Knight of Berkshire and Wiltshire, Sheriff of Edinburgh, 1298 to 1303. Lamberton, William, Archdeacon of Glasgow, Bishop of St. Andrews, 1297 to 1328. Langton, John, Bishop of Chichester, Chancellor of England. Langton, Walter, Bishop of Coventry and Lichfield, also known as Chester, Treasurer of England. Latham, Sir Henry, Knight of Lancashire, Sheriff of Aberdeen, 1296 to circa 1297. Latimer, Sir William, Yorkshire Knight, Captain of Eastern Scottish Garrisons, 1299, Keeper of Berwick Town and Warden of Eastern March, 1300 to 1, in charge of chevauchees from Roxburgh, 1302 to 3, died 1304. Leeds, Sir Alexander, Yorkshire Knight, Sheriff of Dumbarton, 1296 to 7. Lennox, Malcolm, Earl of, 1290 to 1333. Lincoln, Henry de Lacy, Earl of, given James the Steward's lands, died 1311. Lindsay, Sir Alexander, of Barnwheel. Lindsay, Sir Simon, Lord of Atheret, Captain in Esk Valley for Edward I, 1298, Keeper of Liddell and Hermitage Castles. Livingston, Sir Archibald, Sheriff of Linlithgow, 1301-4, Sheriff of Stirling before 1304. Logan, Sir Walter, Scottish Sheriff of Lanark. MacDonald, Alistair, Lord of Isla, second line of descent from Somerled, King of Argyll, rival for power in Northwest with the MacDougalls, died 1298. MacDougall, Alistair, Lord of Argyll and Lorne, senior line of descent from Somerled, King of Argyll, rival for power in the Northwest with the MacDonalds, died 1310. MacDougall, John, of Lorne, eldest son and heir of Alistair MacDougall. MacDougall, Duncan, son of Alistair MacDougall. MacQuillan, Malcolm, Antrim Lord, interested in Western Isles. MacRuery, Lachlan, of Garmoran, third line of descent from Somerled, King of Argyll, brother of Ruery and Christina, wife of Gart Nate of Mar, married to daughter of Alistair of Argyll. MacRuery, Ruery, brother of Lachlan and Christina. Malcolm III, Canmore, King of Scots, 1058-93. Malherb, Sir Gilbert, Lord of Slamenan and Livylands, Scottish Sheriff of Stirling, circa 1299. Manton, Ralph, King's Cofferer, unofficial paymaster in Scotland. Mar, Donald, Earl of, father-in-law of Robert Bruce, Earl of Carrick, future king, died 1298. Mar, Gart Nate of, eldest son and heir of Donald, Earl of Mar, husband of Christina MacRuery. March, C. Dunbar. Margaret, maid of Norway, daughter of King Eric of Norway and Margaret, daughter of Alexander III, died 1290. Marshal, John, Earl of Lincoln's Bailey in Barony of Renfrew, fortified from James the Steward. Maudley, Sir Robert, Yorkshire Knight, English owner of Durlington Castle. Maul, Sir Thomas, Scottish Constable of Brechin Castle, 1303. Menteith, Alexander, Earl of, captured at Dunbar, released 1297, died 1306. Menteith, Sir John de, brother of Earl Alexander, Sheriff of Dumbarton and Keeper of Castle, 1303-9, died circa 1323. Moyne, Sir John Le, Keeper of Galloway and Nithsdale, 1303. Moram, Sir Herbert, son of Sir Thomas, leader of Scottish army besieging Stirling Castle in 1299. Captured and escaped. Recaptured before 1304. Died 1306. Moram, Sir Thomas, father of Sir Herbert, served Edward. Mortimer, William, royal official, judiciary of Scotia, 1296-7. Mowbray, Sir John, Lord of Methven, member of Sir John Cummin of Badenoch, Junior's Council. Mounts, Sir Ebulo, Sheriff and Constable of Edinburgh Castle, 1303-5. Moulton, Sir Thomas, Lord of Lily's Land, Cumberland, Captain of Cumberland and Westmoreland, 1303, died 1314. Murray, Andrew, son of Sir Andrew Murray of Petty, died 1297. Murray, Sir William, Lord of Tullibarden, in Earldom of Strathearn. Norfolk, Roger Bigod, Earl of, Marshal of England, died 1306. Novelliano, Sir Montesini de Gascon Knight, Constable of Ayr Castle, circa 1301. Ormsby, William, Royal Official, Justiciar of Lothian, 1296-7. Pencaitland, John, Keeper of Jedburgh Castle for Scots, 1297-8. Percy, Sir Henry, Yorkshire Knight, Warden of Galloway and Ayrshire, 1296-7, 1273-1314. Philip IV, the Fair, King of France, 1268-1314. Pilch, Alexander, Leader of Burgesses of Inverness. Redmayne, Sir Matthew, Knight of Northumberland and Cumberland, Sheriff of Dumfries, 1304. Ross, Sir Robert de, Lord of Wark, struck first blow of the war for the Scots, supposedly because of his love for a Scottish lady. Ross, Sir William de, claimant to throne through illegitimate descent, brother of Robert de Ross, but on English side. Ross, William, Earl of, remained in prison after Dunbar till 1303. Left tenant beyond the Spey, 1303-5, died 1323. Rue, William, royal clerk, responsible for supplying Edinburgh, Dalton, and Stirling. Rye, Rithry, Henry, royal official, escheator north of the Forth and keeper of Elgin and Forres castles, 1296-7. St. Andrews, Bishop of, C. Fraser, Lamberton. St. George, Master James de, famous master carpenter from Savoy, worked on Linlithgow. St. John, Sir John de, Senior, Lord of Basing, Hampshire, Warden of Galloway, 1300-1302, effectively Lieutenant of Scotland, died 1302. Samson, John, English Constable of Stirling Castle, 1298-1300. Sandale, John, Chamberlain of Scotland, 1305. Seagrave, Sir John, Oxfordshire Knight, in charge of chevauchees from Berwick, 1302-3. Keeper of Berwick Castle, 1302-3. Lieutenant in Eastern Scotland, 1303-4. Lieutenant south of Forth and Justiciar of Lothian, 1304-5. Died 1325. Seward, Sir Richard, Lord of Tibbers, captured at Dunbar, Warden of Nithsdale, 1299, Sheriff of Fife, 1304. Scotter, Roger, Royal Official, Justiciar of Galloway, 1296-7. Spaldington, Osbert, Lincolnshire Knight, Sheriff of Berwick, 1296-8. Sewells, Sir John, Guardian of Scotland, 1301-3. Died in exile in France, 1318. Sewells, Sir Thomas, youngest brother of Sir John and Sir William. Sewells, Sir William, Lord of Liddesdale, Butler of Scotland, elder brother of Sir John, died 1293, succeeded by his brother, Nicholas. Sewells, William, Lord of Liddesdale, Butler of Scotland, son of Nicholas, nephew of Sir John and Sir William. Steward, James the Guardian of Scotland, 1286-92, close associate of Bruce's. Grandfather of future King, Robert II, died 1309. Stuart, Sir John, of Jedburgh, brother of James, leader of the archers of Selkirk Forest, died 1298. Strathearn, Master Alpin of, probably a son of the Earl of Strathearn, Archdeacon of St. Andrews, King John Balliol's treasurer, Bishop of Dunblane, in 1296. Strathearn, Malise, Earl of. Captured at Dunbar, subsequently sided with Edward I, deputy of Earl of Athol as Lieutenant North of the Forth, 1305. Surrey, John de Warenne, Earl of. First post-conquest lieutenant in Scotland, 1296-8. Died 1304. Sutherland, William, Earl of. Died circa 1307. Tay, Sir Walter. Knight of Yorkshire and Bedfordshire. Officer in Esk Valley, 1298. Captain of Berwick Town Garrison, 1300-1. Died 1324. Tilliol, Sir Robert. Cumberland Knight, Constable of Lochmaben, 1301. Died 1321. Twenge, Sir Marmaduke. Yorkshire Knight. Died 1323. Ulster, Richard de Burgh, Earl of. Father-in-law of Robert Bruce, Earl of Carrick, the future king. Umfraville, Sir Ingram de. Scottish Sheriff of Roxburgh, 1299. Guardian of Scotland, 1300-1. Umfraville, Thomas de. Younger son of Earl Gilbert of Angus, Constable of Dundee, traditionally controlled by his family, 1303-4. Umfraville, C. Angus. Valence, Sir Aymer de. Later Earl of Pembroke, given Murray Castle of Bothwell, Lieutenant in Southern Scotland, 1303. Vernet, Sir Philip, Keeper of Berwick Town, 1298-9. Waldegrave, Sir Richard, Northamptonshire Knight, Sheriff of Stirling, 1296-7. Wallace, William, Guardian of Scotland, circa 1297-8, died 1305. Warwick, Guy Beecham, Earl of, died 1315. Warwick, William, Earl of, died 1298. Weston, John, Receiver and Paymaster in South East Scotland, 1299 to circa 1302. William I, the Conqueror, Duke of Normandy, King of England, 1066-87. William I, the Lion, King of Scots, 1165-1214, captured and forced to concede Treaty of Falaise, 1174. Willoughby, Philip, former Keeper of Wardrobe, English treasurer's lieutenant. Wishart, Robert, Bishop of Glasgow, 1271 to 1316, staunch defender of Scotland's independence. Unless otherwise stated, all military administrative offices were held by the aforementioned as part of Edward's government of Scotland. I venture to say, no war can be long carried on against the will of the people. Edmund Burke. Introduction. In praise of fact and fiction. The death of rulers is traditionally accompanied by much weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Cynics might say that in many, most cases, this should be interpreted as a display of political acumen in the face of changing political circumstances, or a rededication of adherence to the regime, rather than genuine emotion. The tears shed at the funeral of Alexander III of Scotland would no doubt have been similarly expedient, had it not been for the dreadful shock of his untimely death and the knowledge that there was no male heir to succeed him. But Scotland's leaders were more than capable of guiding the ship of state for as long as necessary until the next monarch was ready to take the helm. They'd done it before, and would no doubt have to do it again. But in only a decade, when Edward I of England invaded and conquered his northern neighbour, it became clear that 19th March 1286 had ushered in a period of great misfortune for Scotland, and the writers of history soon began to feel a profound nostalgia for Alexander and his reign. The traumas of the wars with England bit deep into the Scottish psyche, casting sweetness and light onto what came before. When Alexander, our king, was dead, that Scotland led in love and security, departed was abundance of ale and bread, of wine and wax, of games and glee. Indeed, succeeding events have provided Scottish history not only with a supposed 13th century golden age, but also advanced the cause of the later medieval Scottish kings, at least in their own propaganda, by rendering them essential to the survival of the nation itself. Ironically, much later politicians of a Whiggish persuasion turned to the same period for evidence of a popular sovereignty restraining the monarchy. War is the natural environment of propaganda, whether to confound the enemy or to bolster morale. Periods of conflict between nations provide particularly fertile ground for polarized, black and white versions of events as governments seek to justify opposing military positions. As time passes and such conflicts enter both history and folklore, new political agendas are given a wider context and legitimacy by harking back to an already simplified past. This is as true for the present as it is for the Middle Ages. In this way, the past, or at least the currently acceptable version of it, is transformed to meet the needs of the moment and crystallizes to become a cast-iron truth. The results often have little to do with the beliefs and aspirations of the protagonists in the original conflict. Having said that, there is no need to deny the importance of the late 13th and 14th centuries to the development of both a Scottish and an English national consciousness, albeit for slightly different reasons. Nor does an acknowledgement of the role of propaganda and mythology in the creation of versions of the past undermine any general discussion of the prosecution of, or resistance to, a war of conquest. The history of the struggle between Edward I and the Scots is comparatively well known at both an academic and a popular level. After all, the period produced two of Scotland's greatest heroes, William Wallace and Robert Bruce, and eventually earned King Edward the sobriquet of Hammer of the Scots. However, the history of the Middle Ages, and of medieval Scotland in particular, remains stubbornly imprisoned in the popular mind as dark, dreary and violent, and more importantly, as comparatively undocumented and therefore unknowable. Certainly, the fact that the history of this struggle must be constructed largely from English sources, mostly official government records and contemporary English chroniclers, has, understandably, given undue emphasis to Edward's government of Scotland. This is all the more unfortunate given that much of Scotland was not under English control between 1297 and 1303. Nevertheless, historians have already done much to illuminate this first phase of the Anglo-Scottish Wars. Such studies fall into two main categories: to shed as much light as possible on the activities of the Scots, or to analyse the English war machine, but particularly the army, as part of studies of Edward I's government and military activity generally. In both cases, the milestones on the way have tended to be the military highlights, battles and sieges. This is natural, after all. There were campaigns every year during the period from 1296 to 1304, with the exceptions of 1299 and 1302, and battles will probably always fire the imagination to greater effect than descriptions of administration. However, these explosions of military activity form, at best, only half the story, since the success of any conquest does not rely ultimately on victory in battle, but on the ability of the occupying regime to transform such victories into an effective and accepted administrative system. It is of paramount importance that Edward's government of Scotland should be returned to centre stage. By shifting our attention on the day-to-day activities of Edwardian officials, the process of conquest and attempted colonisation of one medieval kingdom by another can be brought more firmly into focus. Correspondingly, though still frustratingly inadequately, the means whereby the Kingdom of Scotland was able to marshal its resources and create a coherent and cohesive national movement to deal with an enemy, much more powerful than itself, also become clearer. I have taken the decision to end this book with Edward presiding over the final settlement of Scotland in September 1305. The point at which he surely believed he had succeeded in bringing his northernmost conquest under firm but fair control, rather than at his death 2 years later, when it was clear that he had not. Within only a few months of that 1305 settlement, Robert Bruce killed John Cummin and seized the Scottish throne, precipitating the two nations back into conflict, as well as starting a civil war within Scotland itself. But those hostilities continued, off and on, for another 26 years, until the temporary respite brought about by the Anglo-Scottish Peace Treaty of 1328. It seemed wise, therefore, to focus on the period of warfare between 1296 and 1304, as well as the mopping-up period immediately thereafter, rather than opening a new can of worms that would have to be left largely unexamined. As already mentioned, one of the most frustrating aspects of the study of this period of Anglo-Scottish warfare is the lack of surviving evidence from Scotland itself. This is particularly irritating when it comes to assessing the extent and effectiveness of the Scottish administration set up by Wallace and continued by a series of guardians after the latter's fall from power. It is not truly possible to gauge exactly what the English administration in Scotland was up against, especially in terms of the military and fiscal organisation of the enemy. Equally, we have no way of knowing what overall policies and specific military stratagems the various Scottish leaders attempted to implement over these years. Actions and results will largely have to speak for themselves. In any case, even the comparatively full English sources provide only a very narrow focus. We are thus very well informed about the response of Edward's government and its various departments to the war, both at home and abroad. We also have the reactions of a number of monastic and other commentators to such activities at varying distances from them. However, we have few direct reactions from either the English or the Scots in general, though we know that its cost was disliked in England and that xenophobia rose up like a hydra on both sides of the border within a short space of time. But the problems posed by questions of evidence should not stop us trying to understand what happened by the criteria which contemporaries would themselves have applied both to their own actions and those of their political leaders, so far as we can uncover them. The Kingdom of Scotland was certainly not isolated from the wider medieval world. Indeed, the extent of its involvement, trade and diplomacy are only the most obvious elements, is one of the more striking features of this period. This was a complex society, which was neither monolithic at any one time nor static. Part of the historian's job is to understand how versions of the past have come about in order to separate fact from fiction, while acknowledging the role of both. Fact is, of course, multifaceted. There is no one version of events, even as they are occurring. Fiction, ironically, has a closer relationship to truth than history ever can. Its creators do not have to cover all the options or point out the difficulties with the sources, as the historian does. Then there is the twilight zone between the two. Works such as Barber's Bruce and Blind Harry's Wallace, and even the 1995 film Braveheart, which, while based on a modicum of fact, are primarily a reflection of the events and agendas of their own times. It is only recently, indeed, that historians have realised the extent to which our understanding of the Anglo-Scottish Wars is a product of the comprehensive propaganda campaign conducted by King Robert Bruce against not only his predecessor, John Balliol, but also his arch-enemies, the Cummins, leaders of the Scottish political community, before 1306. Analysis of the war has also been coloured by the commonly held and disparaging view of Scotland's medieval political system, still believed by some Scots, in contrast to that of England particularly. This has obscured the fact that that system was both sophisticated and appropriate to a kingdom that was not England. It has also made it more difficult to understand how resistance to Edward could have been so successful. This whole spectrum of fact and fiction informs each generation's perceptions of the past, and each of us must choose what makes sense. We cannot alter what happened, nor know the truth of it, but we can certainly be aware of what has brought us to our conclusions. At the same time, if we did not believe that events of many hundreds of years ago had some resonance for our own times, we would surely take little interest in them. While the inhabitants of the Middle Ages certainly did things differently, we can still identify with the basic human motivations common to all eras. The desire to protect one's family, to live as normal a life as possible, and, if we are honest, to strut on a wider stage from time to time than that allotted to us. It also seems to be human nature to subsequently portray decisions taken in accordance with these basic desires as noble and glorious, when, as we will see, they are more often mundane, contingent, and myopic. That is perhaps the basic symbiotic relationship between fact and fiction and, as Napoleon Bonaparte reputedly remarked, "What is history but a fable agreed upon?" Chapter 1. The Lion and the Leopard. Where stood Scotland at the end of the 13th century? That is the question we must ask, so that we might better understand not only why Edward I went to such lengths to add his northern neighbour to his portfolio of acquisitions, but how resistance to his conquest proved so successful, up to a point. Then, as now, Scotland was a land of formidable contrasts. Ancient seismic forces having created great mountain barriers, particularly between highlands and lowlands. Soils were often poor for growing crops, but there was good arable land in the south and east, and the uplands can sustain sheep and cattle and all manner of wild beasts. There was coal, lead, silver and gold in the ground, as well as valuable commodities like timber and salt above it. The short winter days were largely bereft of the sun's goodness, and those with the power to entertain through the long nights must have been highly prized in the past, when there was little to do at this unproductive time of year. Long before the Roman legions arrived in the 1st century AD, the tribes of northern Britain had become hierarchical and warlike, with architecture reflecting the power and authority of their chiefs. Partly in, but mostly out, of the Roman Empire, even tribes some distance away from the walls, built to keep them at bay, enjoyed the benefits of imperial trading networks. And once the Romans finally left in the 5th century, continental trade continued, though it looks as if there was a degree of social collapse, even in areas not actually part of the empire. Nevertheless, a number of kings, in Argyll in the west, Athol in the central highlands, and the area around Inverness in the north, soon emerged, consolidating their power and control of resources by military might and the attractive tenets of Christianity, which spread across these nascent kingdoms from the 6th century. Scotland itself first comes on record in 900 AD. Sharing the Gaelic language with the inhabitants of Ireland, the Scots laboured under threats from the recently arrived Norse. But the new kingdom survived and even expanded into English territory beyond the River Forth, which had marked the kingdom's original southern boundary. After William of Normandy's conquest of England in 1066, Scottish kings copied what they fancied from the well-organized Normans, introducing innovation in agriculture, religious institutions, trading frameworks, royal administration and military organisation. But they were happy to keep traditional practices where it suited. The nation's story still bound up with an ancient connection to Ireland, whose Gaelic language was spoken, along with Norman French, by many nobles, and probably the king too. Scotland's racial makeup was complicated, as is that of most nations. Most obviously because its boundaries extended into other kingdoms, but also because its kings had encouraged a considerable influx of useful foreigners. Officially, it encompassed Scots, Anglo-Saxons, Britons, and Normans. The kingdom's social and political culture still tending to privilege local power structures and customs. Nevertheless, by 1200, Scotland had coalesced, according to its leaders at least, into a single Scottish people, bound together by the comparatively undemanding but nonetheless unifying figure of their king. It had certainly not all been plain sailing. Conflicts within the royal family and with powerful nobles, never mind outsiders, were a blight on political and cultural life almost from the moment Scotland was born and continued into the 13th century. And by that century too, a fundamental divide had already opened up between Highlanders and Lowlanders. In part, it was a recognition of the very different topographies of each region, broadly speaking, with settled peaceful farmers minding their own business in the lowlands and lawless cowmen causing havoc in the highlands. This point of view was articulated from an unapologetically lowland perspective and so must be treated with much caution. But in the 13th century, royal authority started to become more forceful, more inclined to speak for the whole kingdom, even if the king himself ruled, with the consent, testimony and acquiescence of my bishops, earls and barons. He also worked hard, seeing and being seen regularly across the core of his kingdom, from the Tweed to the Tay, collecting and dispersing royal revenues, giving justice and managing disputes. It no doubt helped that this was a time of general prosperity at the end of a comparatively warm period. A roaring trade in wool, bought up sometimes years in advance by the cloth makers of Flanders in particular, brought wealth in the form of the great customs on trade into royal coffers and into the pockets of landowners great and small. Berwick, based on its peninsular site between the River Tweed and the North Sea, and right on the border with England, grew into a port of great strategic and commercial importance. By the later 13th century, it was by far the most prosperous town in Scotland, primarily as the conduit through which the wool exported by the great border abbeys flowed. Both the Germans and the Flemings probably had merchants' halls there. This, then, was a time of peace and, so far as we can tell, prosperity. Though Alexander III had far less revenue at his disposal than the rulers of the more centralised kingdoms of England and France, he was easily the richest man in Scotland and, since his government was less intensive and his military activities negligible, give or take the tussle with the Norwegians in 1263, his outgoings were much less too. It certainly helped that, despite perceptions to the contrary, the relationship between England and Scotland, the two kingdoms of the island of Great Britain, was, from the later 13th century, characterised by the very opposite of the fierce animosity that erupted after the outbreak of war in 1296. Indeed, war was one of the least likely scenarios that political pundits might have predicted in the aftermath of Alexander III's untimely death a decade earlier. This is not meant to imply that there hadn't been problems in relations between the two kingdoms, up to and including the intermittent outbreak of overt hostilities, nor that racial taunting of the type well known in modern sporting arenas was alien to 13th century Scots and English. Abuse and suspicion certainly existed, but among those whose responsibility it was to shape and steer the destinies of each kingdom, the lay and ecclesiastical elites, there was a deep-seated and fairly comfortable relationship based on shared kin, language, Norman-French for the nobles and Latin for the churchmen, and values. Indeed, it has been pointed out that a constant fixation on borders and distinct kingdoms can obscure as much as it illuminates. This was an age when local and transnational political associations were often paramount, the national hesitant and fragile. Both in peace and in war, the interests of the 13th century Scottish and English monarchies, together with the landholding class immediately beneath, flowed across and diluted the effects of the border. Indeed, it has been calculated that at some stage during the 13th century, 9 out of 13 Scottish earldoms had English property, while 7 out of 22 English earldoms had Scottish interests. Intermarriage meant, to take only one example, that Edward I of England was brother-in-law to Alexander III of Scotland, and therefore great-uncle to the young Margaret of Norway, Alexander's granddaughter and heir presumptive to the Scottish throne from 1284. King John Balliol, who reigned from 1292, was son-in-law to John de Warenne, Earl of Surrey, who defeated Balliol's army at Dunbar in 1296, and then became Edward's lieutenant in Scotland. But there was one important bone of contention that had long threatened good relations between the two kingdoms and which consistently exposed the Scots as the aggressors. Scotland's kings had had a tendency to view Northumbria and Cumbria, parts of the once powerful kingdoms of Northumbria, Anglo-Saxon, and Strathclyde, British, as fair game for conquest. Indeed, they had acquired the northern tip of Northumbria from the River Forth to the River Tweed as early as the 10th century, and saw no reason to stop there. They were often to be found south of the Solway or Tweed, pursuing these claims as belligerently as possible, particularly in times of English weakness, such as the Civil War following Henry I's death in 1135. The English claim to overlordship was even more long-standing, becoming a consistent expression of the superiority of the West Saxon kings over all other rulers in the British Isles in the 10th century. With the Norman conquest, the concept of an overarching British kingship vested in the kings of England was readily inherited. In 1072, Malcolm III of Scotland became King William of England's man, the formal feudal method of accepting another's lordship, after the latter led an army deep into Scotland. This had only become necessary, however, because Malcolm had wrongly presumed that William's difficulties in the north of his kingdom in the aftermath of his conquest of England in 1066 provided an ideal opportunity for promoting his own ambitions in the area. This encapsulates the basic relationship between the two crowns. English kings remained uninterested in Scotland so long as the border stayed where it was and peaceful. Scottish kings continued to exploit potential English weakness, but were usually brought round to an understanding and acknowledgement of the military superiority of the English crown. A resolution of the problem was not forthcoming until 1237, when Alexander II of Scotland agreed to abandon his claims to Northumberland in the Treaty of York in return for lucrative English lands. Now that this long-standing issue had been resolved, there was little to hinder good relations. Whatever the legal arguments, English claims to superiority were really a practical expression of the imbalance of power vested in the two crowns, given the resources available to each. Such an imbalance did not challenge the effective sovereignty of Scotland's kings or the independence of the Northern Kingdom, especially as most English kings had far more pressing issues to deal with when it came to their own extensive landed possessions in France. Even the Treaty of Falaise, 1174, which permitted Henry II to garrison 3 Scottish border castles after the Scottish king, William I, managed to get himself captured in Northumberland, was not an attempt to interfere with Scottish government, but an extension of the usual, largely ineffectual, methods of guaranteeing Scottish good behaviour. But times did change, and centuries of acceptance of this big king, little king relationship, grudging or otherwise, became challenging after 1200. In the first instance, the loss of Normandy and Anjou loosened the English crown's connections with the continent, though they still held Gascony, prompting an increased interest in British affairs, particularly after 1259, when these losses were formally recognised. Secondly, developments in legal definitions of rights and jurisdictions were beginning to make it more difficult to maintain conflicting positions within the hierarchical structure of Western European society. By the mid-13th century, the kings of Scotland had no problem with paying homage and fealty to the English king for their English lands, but they would no longer tolerate the idea that their kingship might be dependent, in any sense, on a greater earthly authority. Kings were kings, and sovereignty was not relative. The kings of England, of course, maintained the opposite view. The admissions of superiority, which had accrued over the years, could not be undone, and might even acquire greater definition as legal rights became more refined. Technically speaking, the issue of holding land of another king and the implications for sovereignty were quite separate, but the two were often interlinked. The issue of the status of the Kingdom of Scotland, for example, was only brought up when the King of Scots went to pay homage and fealty for his English lands. Both Alexander II and Alexander III categorically refused to accept that they were bound to do so for the Kingdom of Scotland. Equally, Henry III and Edward I, while not pressing the point, reserved the right to demand acceptance of their overlordship in the future. The clash of these conflicting interpretations of rights was not restricted to Scotland and England. Indeed, the King of France, Philip IV, who came from the line of kings who pointedly upheld the doctrine that they themselves did homage to no man, energetically challenged Edward I's understanding of his own sovereignty by interfering in the latter's dukedom of Gascony. However, in the case of Scotland and England, no one thought these technical difficulties would lead to war. Indeed, both Henry and Edward had no desire to strain the relationship between the two kingdoms, however much they believed in their own rights. There was far too much to be gained from peace to warrant its deliberate sabotaging. But history is littered with moments when circumstances conspire to give one point of view a practical advantage over another. And it would be an unusual leader indeed who failed to take advantage of them. And certainly the unthinkable did happen. In one of history's little ironies, Alexander III, aged only 44, brought his dynasty to an end by making a fatally romantic dash to attempt to perpetuate it with his new young second wife. All the children of his first marriage had already predeceased him, leaving as heir presumptive his granddaughter, a young Norwegian princess. The Scottish elites had only reluctantly accepted this Margaret as a potential ruler of Scotland in 1284, after the death of Alexander's two sons, no doubt agreeing primarily because choosing a male heir from the fringes of the dynasty was far too daunting a task. It was easier to assume that the king still had plenty of time to produce another boy. However, the Scottish political community's reaction to the latterer's untimely death and the eventual arrangements made for the maid and her future as Queen of Scots, she was not formally accepted as heir till October 1286, when Alexander's queen probably gave birth to a posthumous stillborn child, reflected both the maturity of the Scottish political system and the close relationship that England and Scotland now enjoyed. Margaret of Norway's great-uncle, Edward I of England, was in the prime of his life and his reign. In his late 40s, he had ruled the Southern Kingdom for nearly 15 years and had already laid down the foundations of the conquest of Wales and the reformation of English finance, administration, and law. Ahead of him was still the final subjugation of Wales, the outbreak of a very serious quarrel with Philip of France, and the difficult years of domestic political wrangling, which was both characteristic of English crown magnate relations of the 13th century and a product of the dynamic and intensive style of government presided over by Edward himself. Despite the historical revisionism popular in our own time, he is still regarded as a great English king, if not on a par with Henry V or even his own grandson, Edward III. Though it is no longer fashionable to define a monarch's success by his contributions to expansionism and centralism, per se, it is still difficult not to be impressed. Edward's energy, his fierce intelligence, and even his ruthlessness did indeed provide him with remarkable success in these two areas. Scotland's bad luck lay not only in the failure of the dynastic line, but in having such a king as nearest neighbour. However, we must not get carried away by hindsight. In the immediate aftermath of Alexander's death in March 1286, during the hiatus of his queen's pregnancy, Edward showed remarkably little interest in the Northern Kingdom, other than making conventional expressions of sympathy, until the Scottish guardians themselves approached him a few months later. That they should do so was also entirely conventional, given that the Scottish royal family was so closely related to Edward that the Scots were quite accustomed to leaning on England's broad shoulders in times of difficulty, such as Alexander III's own minority, and that Edward was regarded as one of Western Europe's foremost statesmen. Indeed, it was mere courtesy to inform Britain's most dominant player of events which could have a potential impact on his kingdom, not least because Scotland's leaders already needed to take precautions against the nightmare of a civil war promoted by Robert Bruce of Annandale, an adult male alternative for the throne. However, once the approach for advice had been made by the Scottish guardians, six nobles and senior churchmen appointed from within the political community to run the country, any search for an understanding of Edward's intentions immediately unleashes a hail of questions. But there is no need to impute sinister motives to the English king to begin with, not least because his proposed solution to Scotland's problems, a marriage between Margaret and his own only surviving son, Edward, won general approval in the Northern Kingdom, even if the maid's father, King Eric of Norway, was less overtly happy. That the union of the crowns of England and Scotland envisaged by the marriage did not happen is perhaps as much of a tragedy as the early death of King Alexander. On the other hand, the fact that, among other things, Edward took control of the strategically vital Isle of Man, in Scottish hands officially since 1266, around the same time as he was promising to uphold the integrity of the Scottish crown, suggests he was already happy to subordinate the Northern Kingdom's rights to his own advantage. But even he cannot have believed that such advantage was likely to be anything other than temporary. In any event, the maid's own demise, perhaps from food poisoning on her father's island of Orkney in the autumn of 1290, meant that the carefully formulated expressions of equality between the two kingdoms laid out in the Treaty of Bergen, July 1290, as demanded by the Scots, became null and void. From then on, the quest for the peaceful accession of a new king moved Anglo-Scottish relations into uncharted and distinctly murky waters. And it is surely now that we can see Edward preparing to take advantage of leaderless Scotland to push a far more radical agenda of his own, to see if he could subordinate the northern kingdom to his own authority by means of a formerly subservient Scottish king. It is now much easier to understand how he manipulated the two-year court proceedings, 1291-2, to identify Alexander's rightful heir to his own advantage, as well as using them as the legal basis for his direct takeover of the Scottish kingdom in 1296. This involved the rewriting or deliberate suppression of evidence so that the English king could show he was accepted as Lord Superior of Scotland by the Scottish political community as part of the process of choosing a new king, something Scotland's leaders did not think they had done, or at least not permanently. Understanding this process, comparing what seems to have happened with the version presented a few years later, is a torturous affair. In the immediate aftermath of the maid's death, there were only two claimants to the Scottish throne, John Balliol and Robert Bruce. Balliol was descended from the eldest daughter of David, Earl of Huntingdon, grandson of King David I of Scotland, while Bruce was descended from the second daughter, but was one generation older, that is, a grandson rather than a great-grandson. The Scots knew they could not decide between them themselves, partly because this would imply their king could be subject to election by his nobility, but mostly because each candidate was supported by different factions within the kingdom. That was why they needed Edward, who had enough clout to make sure the decision on whether Bruce or Balliol should be king was upheld. However, the English king had already realised that the death of the maid, though marking the slamming shut of one door, could open another. Edward now seized the initiative, summoning the Scots to a parliament to be held at Norham on the southern bank of the River Tweed on 6th May 1291 to deal with the thorny issue of who should be the next king in Scotland. The Scots duly came south but remained at Upsettlington, just north of the border. Their intention was to have the king come to them, as Edward was required to do by the marriage treaty of Burgum, if he was dealing with Scottish affairs, so that there would be no question of the Scots admitting his authority over them by going into England. However, they had not understood that there was now a new set of rules, though it soon became very clear that Edward was not budging from Norham. In an attempt to break the deadlock, a small group of Scots crossed the Tweed on 10th May. This deputation was treated to an extraordinary exposition from Edward through the mouth of his justice, Roger Brabazon. Though its main thrust related to the king's desire to see the vacant Scottish throne justly filled, it also contained two extremely portentous elements. The first was the most obvious, a demand for both assent to and recognition of Edward's overlordship as the prelude to his settlement of the succession. The second was a hint, for the first time, that that settlement was more than a simple adjudication between Bruce and Balliol. The Scots, led by the Bishop of Glasgow, Robert Wishart, reacted with shock and anger, but were then, according to Scottish sources, threatened with military action, the suggestion that Edward's temper was only just held in check would have been entirely believable. They thus had little choice but to return across the border to consult with their colleagues, having at least gained a 3-week adjournment. It was apparently during this period that they attempted to wriggle out of the noose being prepared for them by denying their competence to comment on the status of the crown. The burden of defending Scotland.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.